HMS Ocean is the flagship of the Royal Navy.
Thanks, commands approved.
She's Britain's biggest warship.
She's a special lady and she's a one-off. And I think that's why everybody secretly falls in love with Ocean.
She's also a floating village.
Fighting the war against dust.
Her 1,000-strong crew has spent the last 8 weeks preparing to take control of an American-led task force in the Persian Gulf.
Start ahead, starboard engine.
A third of her sailors are at sea for the first time.
Got a postcard from my nan. See it every morning, makes me happy.
And the old ship keeps throwing up problems.
Manual work, take out the strainers, clean them.
Now they're approaching the climax of their mission. Will the ship and her crew be up to scratch? Our cameras have been following Ocean to see what it takes to run a major warship. Evening, November the 6th, and HMS Ocean is 2,000 miles from home at the port of Duqm in Oman. Tomorrow she'll be heading for the Gulf and the most sensitive part of her mission. So the crew has got one last evening to relax. Below deck in the women's mess, 17-year-old apprentice engineer Kira Parry is providing the night's entertainment.
I had my rap night. So I performed live for the mess. That was good. That was awesome. I love my mess. It's awesome. Singing, dancing, rapping, just having a laugh with your mates. It's awesome. Best place of the ship.
Despite the high spirits, Ocean's crew has a testing time ahead. To get to the Gulf, Ocean has to navigate one of the most hostile stretches of water on Earth. A 20-mile wide choke point separating Iran and the Gulf states. The Strait of Hormuz. An encounter with the Iranian Navy is almost guaranteed. Ocean's operations officer, Adam Ridet, is in charge of intelligence.
What we've got here is video from the US warship that went through the Strait of Hormuz earlier in 2016. What she's videoing is four Iranian Republican Guards naval boats that come close, and this is something we fully expect to see because this is effectively Iran's backyard. So we've seen stories in the past about Iranian cruise missiles and swarms of small boats coming out to attack, but arguably not since the 70s has there ever been shots exchanged. So if something does happen, it will be a miscalculation, a mistake. We don't want to escalate that, and frankly, nor do the Iranians.
It's 6 a.m. and Ocean is approaching the choke point.
We're just going through the traffic separation scheme of the Straits of Hormuz, so a road in the sea where we have to stay on this path. The Iranians like to poke everyone with a sharp stick as they go through, so it's a place of disciplined restraint.
On track so far, everyone's behaving themselves and the sun is out, so it's a good day.
For the rest of the ship, the day begins as normal. Breakfast is being readied in the galley. And at 6:30, the call the hand signal is piped through the tannoy. As Ocean comes to life, Captain Pedro takes the bridge.
Yeah, we're about 170 degrees on his port bow.
Because of the potential for trouble, Ocean has been assigned an American destroyer as an escort.
It's a narrow strait of water through which most of the oil in that region flows. It is used sometimes as a political football between Iran and the rest of the Gulf states, and it's inevitable that that will always be the focal point for some form of tension.
Pass watch. Perhaps that's conduct. Thank you very much.
With the USS Hopper riding shotgun, down in the mess halls, the breakfast news has an appropriately American dimension.
We're going to get to work immediately for the American people.
It is. Donald
Trump. Maybe I would vote for him, though. It's crazy.
Do you reckon about the election score? Don't watch it back home in St. Vincent.
Total madness.
There it is. They've got it with the ASCG. That's a great vessel.
Back on the bridge, and an hour into the transit, Ocean has got company.
Fast-moving contact, true bearing at 319, tracking left to right, range approximately 5 miles, all reports on surface.
An unidentified vessel is tracking their transit. It's navigator Mark Hewitt's job to identify the mystery craft.
Signal to watch. Can you label the Hudong on there as an Iranian vessel, so IRN?
It's an Iranian attack boat, a Hudong, built in China.
So the Hudong class is a fast attack craft that the Iranians and a number of other nations operate. Because of her speed and because of that missile capability, it makes them quite versatile, certainly in these littoral waters. It means you can maneuver very quickly, get in close, and could engage with their missile systems, although that is entirely unlikely where we're operating, but it's just a threat that we need to be alive to and be aware of.
As the crew keep careful watch, seven decks below them, the engineers spot a potentially serious problem.
We've lost all chilled water forward, which means we've lost all the chilled water, which is coolant for like our weapons and that. So,
Ocean uses cold, desalinated seawater for air conditioning and to keep its electronic systems cool in the blistering Arabian heat. As of 10 minutes ago, that cooling system crashed.
We appear to have gone over either a patch of seaweed or some fish or shellfish or whatever, and they blocked the strainers. So the team now are just unblocking the strainers, manual work, take out the strainers, clean them, basically like a filter. This isn't the ideal time to do that. That's why the guys are working quickly to restore capability.
350, sir, we've got two fast-moving vessels.
The Hudong is joined by three gunboats. Ocean's American escort is asked to provide a shield.
Got four IRGCM building up on the starboard bow. Hopper's interposing in a moment, but as a precautionary measure, we're closing up body armour now and have all weapons manned on the upper deck.
For the new recruits like Kira, it's a first ever encounter with an unfriendly Navy.
But you got to think about it, obviously, because it's the military and that's what they do. And you're always training, constantly. So they've got to make sure everyone's ready. That's where we do everything. So yeah, everyone here should be ready, if needs be, to go to war.
A dozen more gunboats arrive, and they still haven't formally identified themselves. So the ship issues its first warning.
Issue warning one. Roger. Warning one.
The Iranians split into two separate groups and take turns pursuing Ocean.
Red warning one, no response. Rereading warning one, vessels down.
And as you can see, the manoeuvres from the Iranians are quite aggressive, with vessels turned inbound, you know, four or five vessels closing at very high speed with weapons straight towards the task group. And the absolute key here is that we don't overreact to their provocations. And that's why the weapon teams are all manning their weapons, but we're not training or covering the weapons on the Iranian vessels at this moment, because the biggest risk here is one of miscalculation.
One of those manning the guns is new recruit Amy Yeomans.
I think of everyone else on the ship. Think of like the lives you're protecting, basically, because we're initially protecting the ship. So you just have to do it, otherwise it could be your friends that could potentially be harmed.
The young ABs, they might be 18 years of age, and they're on their first voyage, and it takes quite a lot of training and quite a lot of understanding for them to sit back and watch somebody come towards them and just take our reassurance that they just need to hold fast.
We are contesting the security operation in the Persian Gulf. We are here to safeguard territorial waters.
They're naturally trying to determine our intent and potentially gather intelligence.
As temperatures rise on the bridge, down in engineering, the stokers have succeeded in scraping the sea life off the water filters. Slowly, they bring the cooling system back online.
So, no, we did lose all. We went down to nothing, but now you've got three aft, so you should have chilled water flow and temperature should be coming down, and they're working to get one of the foreign plants on.
So the temperature's okay.
No worries, bye.
Throughout the morning, Ocean has been shadowed by up to 18 separate Iranian boats. Now they try a new trick on the British crew.
Yeah, there's a drone. Drone clearly visible.
We've got a drone tracking us at the moment.
Drone in the water.
The Iranian drone has crashed into the water.
The Iranian drone has just crashed.
The loss of the drone seems to deflate their uninvited escorts, who start to back off. The threat level decreases, the body armour is removed, and the bridge begins to wind down.
We'll debrief shortly.
After 6 hours, Ocean clears the strait.
Well, I think we've seen a pretty standard pattern of Iranian activity, albeit to have had interactions with some 18 Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps Navy vessels is quite a high number, it's probably fair to say, but equally it's a while since they've seen a Royal Navy aircraft carrier operating in this area, so they've evidently rolled out the red carpet for us today to welcome us into the Gulf.
The crew has remained calm under pressure and avoided any incident.
You know, I'm really proud of them, because it's too easy to just remember your Hollywood movies and go all medieval every time you see the enemy. But for here, it takes real intelligence and restraint to recognise the situation for what it was, which is two navies just having a look at each other in the same stretch of water.
Now Ocean can focus on the next stage of her mission, to command CTF-50, the American-led naval task force in the Gulf. Stoker Michael Hedgecock is the fifth generation of his family to serve in the Royal Navy. But even born sailors like Michael can have an off day on a long voyage.
Some days when you've had a really bad day, and you just want a bit of fatherly advice, just to say, listen, Dad, X, Y, and Z's happened. I just need someone to chat to, or can we just go for a pint and just chill? Sometimes you just need your mum and your dad just to say everything's going to be all right.
Homesickness is the enemy of good morale. Luckily, there is an antidote. The Post.
Over there.
Ships get deliveries either at sea or when they arrive in port. Today, there are 66 sacks worth of parcels and letters. Some sections of the crew account for more of it than others.
Girls mess always does really well. There's always tons.
Why do you think that is?
Because we're just loved. We're just loved more than everybody else.
Apprentice stoker Kate Benson has got two sacks full of love for her mess.
Today, I've got some salmon, some mug shots, and chocolate biscuits. That's my favourite. I got a little parcel the other day, and there was just a little note in there. Just mix it a bit better to receive.
Even like a card, I think
it's
like good, isn't it?
Yeah.
Got a postcard from my nan. Love it. See, every morning makes me happy.
The mail makes everyone's day.
Right, so I've got to open some mail.
Even the captain, who has a bundle of parcels from his parents.
It's a book on history. Max Hastings, Battle for Japan, which is a subject I'm pretty interested in. I suspect another book. Yeah, Turning the Tide, Battle of Coral Sea, an absolute essential read. Yep, lots of books. But plenty of reading material for the future, so that's good.
It's just 2 weeks until Ocean becomes the command centre for CTF-50, the American task force in the Gulf. As the countdown to the handover continues, Ocean goes through her final preparations. Today, they're loading and test firing the three Phalanx automatic defence guns, capable of shredding missiles and fighter planes.
Mandate correct.
Phalanx, command approved.
The woman with her finger on the trigger is weapons officer Danielle Hopkins.
What we're doing today is making sure that we are actually accurate, so when we fire, we haven't got an error or a great error, which would mean that we could end up hitting something else by accident. It's got an effective range about 4,000 yards, and it fires 4,500 rounds a minute. So, quite a lot.
Shot. Hold fire.
Drills. Good drills.
It's not only the weapons that are being discharged. Nine decks down is a vital component of this 23,000-ton war machine. The crew call it the poo plant. Maritime regulations insist that all human waste is processed before being jettisoned at sea. Stokers Rhys Clayton and Mitchell Blair do the job no one else on the ship wants, even though it comes with extra pay.
I can't remember where I take them from.
The first part of the process, the screen press, gets rid of your toilet paper, anything that can't be fitted through the system. From here, your filtrate goes to stage two. That's where your bacteria break down the organic matter.
This is where they earn their extra money, because there's only one way to check if the process is working.
You have a little smell. Good is earthy, like dirt, so you want it earthy. Bad is like eggs. You know, sulfite, it's not nice. But you smell it and I will pull a face, that's how you know it's bad.
And then it then gets passed on to these filters, turns it into permeate.
Your permeate goes to your permeate tank and discharged overboard.
This is the final product of our wonderful poo plant. This is processed, poo up we. Technically clean water, which is supposed to be drinkable, but you know.
Go on then.
Not drinking that.
They need a volunteer.
Ed's got to try it, yeah.
Anyway, you'd be getting a drink,
he'll have a sit.
Q, H, Hedgecock.
Hedgecock, you'll try this, won't you? I think you're the man for the challenge. Oh, class. Class. Remember, Dave, you're going to be sick. That's just proven the snake's drinkable, but it clearly isn't. You know, as you can see there.
Today, a senior British officer, a Commodore, is arriving to prepare for the CTF-50 handover, which has prompted the crew to engage in an all-out attack on dirt and grime.
Fighting the war against dust.
The Commodore will run operations from Ocean alongside a staff of 20 officers.
They have been asked by the Americans to take charge of strike operations in the Gulf for a period of 3 months. So they are here on the ship using us as a command platform to be the headquarters in charge of those operations. So it's as simple as that. So Ocean provides them with beds, bunks, beans, communications infrastructure, intelligence, and all the real life support that they need.
Providing the bed, bunk and beans is Executive Warrant Officer Carl Steedman. He's already been busy taking care of the Commodore's advance party.
Sir, all well?
Yes, thank you.
Welcome aboard. You are like a gaggle of divas. You've come heavy-handed with bags. I'm just going to stick my head in the Commodore's cabin, make sure everything's squared away, tickety-boo. Obviously, Commodore Burns, his name's now on the door, and he's got a cabin with all his IT and all that ready for him to execute CTF-50 duties in the Gulf. He's then got a bunk out the back and the shower and all bits and pieces, so it's pretty much allows the Commodore to be self-sufficient here and pretty much execute his duties whilst on board Ocean. Good, good, good.
No matter what rank you are, there's only one way to board a warship at sea.
Project A, can we make one final clear off the FDF pipe, please?
British Commodore Andrew Burns will arrive through the maritime equivalent of the tradesman's entrance, known on ship as the pilot's hatch. A Commodore is responsible for a squadron of ships and is one rank below a rear admiral, which means he gets his own flag raised when aboard.
This is my 8th deployment to the Middle East and the Gulf region, so it's pretty familiar territory to me, and it's a difficult part of the world to operate in. It's particularly challenging right now because there is instability all the way around the Gulf region and terrorist organisations operating to the north in the shape of ISIS and to the south in the form of Al-Qaeda. We know those organisations are developing waterborne threats and we have to be ready to deal with those.
Start ahead, starboard engine.
Ocean is now on course for a rendezvous with the aircraft carrier USS Eisenhower. This nuclear-powered aircraft carrier is 3 times the size of Ocean and has a crew of 5,000. In 2 weeks' time, the British warship will replace her at the head of the task force. New recruits to the Royal Navy have centuries of tradition and regulation to navigate. Today, new recruit Michael Golden is about to encounter one of their more bizarre rules.
Yeah, not bad. I want to grow a beard, if that's okay.
So I need you to familiarise yourselves with the policy of BR3.
If you want a beard in the Navy, you need the right paperwork.
So in order to be able to grow a beard, you have to fill out a beard chip, which in effect is a request to cease shaving from a certain date. So what happens then is I'll fill out the form. Having done so, I'll then get that signed by my divisional officer and the Master at Arms. And then in a couple of weeks, she'll take a look, see if it actually is respectable. And if she thinks it is, happy days. If she doesn't, then you have to shave it off, start again.
The Master at Arms is Shelley Hyatt.
What I'm looking for is that it's coming through evenly. There's not gaps everywhere and spaces, or it's the correct length and it's not, it's longer than just a bit of fluff on their chin, basically, and it looks neat and tidy.
On the flight deck, there are more pressing concerns. Captain Pedra and Commodore Burns are preparing to be flown by helicopter to the USS Eisenhower. There, an American admiral will formally hand command of his task force to Commodore Burns and Ocean.
We're direct to November. Thank you. We are minutes away from taking over as the flagship of Commander Task Force 50, so Maritime Coalition Strike Ops in the Gulf. So the Commodore's over there at the moment taking over that duty. And we are just positioning ourselves for a little steam past with USS Eisenhower, who is three times the size of us, but certain times size doesn't matter, and this is one of those times, so Ocean's perfectly good as a command platform.
Does look good, especially with all the jets on the flight deck and helicopters going on and off. It does look professional. Not that ours doesn't.
We just had news that Commodore Burns has taken command of CTF 50, and the rather large, impressive American platform is currently on our port beam at approximately 200 yards. She looks okay, she could do a bit of upper deck work if I'm honest with you, but she hasn't got a white ensign flying at the back of her, so second class.
Okay, job done. That's ceremony complete. So the Eisenhower's just peeling away. She's going to make her way back home, and then we'll continue our patrol in this area. So job done for today, and the fun now starts, I guess.
Ocean is now spearheading a task force of up to 8 warships. Together, they will be responsible for security and the free flow of trade through 2.5 million square miles of open water. Below decks, life in the village at sea retains its routines. For the kitchen staff and stewards, that means squeezing in a darts tournament between shifts.
Yes.
Yeah, it's really good fun, I tell you. The thing is, sometimes because you're in ship, and even though you're free for that period of time, you're still stuck exactly where you were. So that could be a bit challenging sometimes. So it's about getting a bit of activity to use up that free time that you actually have.
You miss your family on a daily basis. It's that's normal, but it's the distractions like this that take your mind off it for a bit. And so it's good. It's passing the time away for the guys. So it's really a good thing for the boys, I think.
Away from the darts match, the Commodore and his staff are getting down to the day-to-day business of running the CTF 50 task force.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Sir, on open source in Yemen.
One of their responsibilities is to coordinate anti-terrorist operations against ISIS and Al-Qaeda groups in the area. So there are daily security briefings.
Michael H992, he's tweeted an image of the Salhan destroyer. This is a domestically built Iranian destroyer, sir, but it's more similar in size to an APB than destroyer.
Okay, thanks, Matt. No questions.
As command ship of CTF 50, Ocean's flight deck has gotten busier. Today she'll welcome aboard an unusual American visitor. The Osprey is half plane, half helicopter, and can tilt its engines mid-air, transforming from one mode to the other in 12 seconds. It has the speed of an airplane, but the landing capability of a helicopter.
So it can carry troops, up to 24 people, over a great range, and at speed. So it gives us that versatility to get people ashore or whatever we need to do with it.
Only the American military operate the Osprey, so its arrival is greeted with genuine curiosity.
This is the first couple of days of CTF 50, so operating the Osprey with the Americans, it's a really good way to start. So, and it's enjoyable, it's something different.
Down in the galley, Marine technician Michael Hedgecock is in big trouble.
We were ashore one night, me and one of my really close friends. Been drinking all day. It was the last stop before we were going home. Got into a bit of an argument. We may or may not have had a fight. And pretty much come from that, he was injured. And that was due to me.
The judge and jury in the case will be Nick Wood.
The reason why we can prosecute our own people at sea is that we don't have access to shoreside justice. I couldn't send this to Hampshire Constabulary to trial. We're on the far side of the world and this man needs to be dealt with, which is why we uniquely in the armed forces retain the right to prosecute our own people. For serious offences, people will be jailed. Today, somebody allegedly has not played by the rules, so we'll have a look at what they've done and I will dispense justice.
My mum and dad have always said, if you've done something wrong, don't try and hide it or lie about it. You admit you're at fault, take it on the chin. If you going to whine about the punishment, you shouldn't have done it in the first place. So I'll see what comes of it. Worst case scenario, my career's basically trashed because of it. I mean, I can always have other Christmases at home, which would be nice, but yeah.
British Commodore has a meeting on the American destroyer, USS Hopper. It's a lively commute. Hopper is one of two American destroyers in the task force. Both carry Tomahawk cruise missiles. These are capable of striking ISIS and Al-Qaeda targets in Iraq. Ocean also has an appointment to keep. She is due to carry out one of her more challenging operations.
Passage, Roger. Tech quarters, port 15, altering 315.
The ship is meeting a floating filling station for ARAS, which stands for Replenishment at Sea. She is topping up her tanks with 400 tons of diesel and a further 200 tons of aviation fuel. It takes 57 gallons to move Ocean 1 nautical mile. The ship uses 7 gallons to travel her own length. That's 667 feet.
Oh, we're getting closer.
For once, Kira is above deck.
Yeah.
She's on comms duty, which means she's a key link between the engine room and the pumping operation.
I love the rats. I think they're awesome. They can get a bit boring, actually, but afterwards you just buzz in. Especially, like, being on the comms, you just feel like you're so important.
In principle, it's just like filling up at a petrol station. In practice, it's a bit more tricky.
As the ships push through the water, they create a pressure wave at the bow, so they push water away from themselves, and that can push, you know, push the ships apart. Luckily, they do that at the back as well. So the front and the back are pushing out, but in the middle, between the two ships, it's actually trying to suck you together. So it balances nicely. But if you get it wrong, and sort of get too far ahead or too far back, then it sort of sucks you together, and that can go a bit disastrously wrong.
Sorry? Starboard 20, altering 325.
Starboard 20.
Very good. Very good.
Almost exactly 50 metres apart, steaming along at 10 knots, 21,000 tonnes on this side, 16,000 tonnes on the other side. Living the dream.
Once they are close enough, they get a line over.
Turn the back for life, boys.
Oh, they've got this like attachment for the SA-80. And they fire it over and it's got like catch on something over there.
Rifle ready!
It's like how you send stuff over.
Fire when ready.
I just think it's cool to watch. Something you don't see every day.
One! Going for the line.
There you go.
Now they can bring over a steel cable, followed by the fuel lines.
So you'll see that coming across, and then we start pumping. We collect our bottle of water and our copy of Auto Trader and our bag of crisps, and we leave the petrol station. Normal drills.
I love this bit.
Start. Twisting their arm thing.
Look at that. Oh. Chris, we started pumping diesel, yeah? Yeah, we started pumping diesel now.
In a pre-health and safety era, ship-to-ship transfer was even used to move people.
When I was 18, I transferred between a couple of frigates, and I think they found out it was my birthday. So they stopped me halfway across and bounced me in and out of the water, singing happy birthday, and I thought it was the best day of my life. So 30 years ago, that was it was a good day, but Christ alive, we do that today. Can't think about it.
It will take over 4 hours to pump the fuel aboard. The cost of filling up today? £200,000.
ETME Hedgecock.
Sir!
Today, Michael Hedgecock will stand trial for assaulting a shipmate.
Off cap. Stand at ease.
Hedgecock is facing the real possibility that he has messed up the only career he has ever wanted.
Paul Hedgecock, you are charged as follows: committing a criminal conduct offence contrary to Section 42 of the Armed Forces Act 2006, namely battery, to Section 39 of the Criminal Justice Act 1988. Do you admit or deny the charge?
Admit, sir.
Do you or your AO on your behalf wish to make a plea in mitigation?
Yes, sir.
AO, please.
Sir. Since the incident in question, Hedgecock has recognised that his actions were unacceptable and he had to identify his shortcomings and take actions to rectify them. Hedgecock has shown clear remorse for his actions and again wishes to apologise unreservedly to all parties concerned and to put the incident behind him.
Thank you, Chief. Well spoken. I do not believe that a custodial sentence is in the service interest, nor do I believe that stoppage of leave is appropriate. Therefore, having found the charge against you proved, I award you a fine of 14 days' pay, totalling £752.64, to be taken over 2 calendar months.
Sir.
I read through an inch thick of case notes. And the one question I have is, why didn't you walk away?
I thought he was going to basically hit me first, and as he is a little bit stronger than me,
yep.
I didn't want to lose face and felt threatened. I thought that was my only way out.
We are only violent towards the enemy, not each other. Right? So we are trained to be violent. It's what we do. But we're also trained when and where to use that violence. Far too many years ago, I stood exactly where you were. Right? So somebody gave me a chance on that day, and now I'm here as the commander of the fleet flagship. So I offer you the same chance today. Use it fully.
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes, sir.
Hey, yeah.
14 days pay.
Look
14 days pay. 750 quid. Very lucky. In the grand scheme of things, that is the best case and the best. I couldn't have asked for better, really. So happy.
Ocean is in port for a VIP visit.
The Prime Minister will be coming on board the vehicle ramp, up the vehicle deck, on the aft lift and onto the flight deck, so we'll make sure that area is nice and clean.
Prime Minister Theresa May is in Bahrain for a post-Brexit trip to drum up trade. But it's also an opportunity for her to come aboard and celebrate the ship taking command of CTF 50. She will give a speech, meet the crew, and thank them for their efforts.
Attention.
Before she arrives, Captain Pedra and Commodore Burns brief the troops to make sure everyone is on message.
Big day today. Prime Minister's visiting. Many of you will have an opportunity to engage with her directly. So just remember some of those themes, the themes for CTF 50. Deterring regional aggression, free flow of commerce, and building partnerships through defence engagement. And also for the Prime Minister in particular, is getting across the fact that working with other government departments, and particularly defence engagement in support of the FCO. So smile, engage with her, and enjoy. On with the brief.
Executive Warrant Officer Carl Steedman is checking that Ocean is shipshape.
Making sure that thing's good to go, if I'm honest with you. My ship's coming in down. A little bit of spring cleaning over the last 24 hours just to give Ocean that little bit of sparkle for the Prime Minister when she comes on board. And now we're just getting ready, just doing the final touches. Morning, folks, how are we? Happy days. Good smiling here, looking good. That's what we like. So when the Prime Minister walks around later on, meets a few members of the ship's company in certain offices and compartments, we're looking our best, which excites me at times. Want to Baby Jones, how are we?
Hi, how are you?
You ready? Baby Jones is going to open the Prime Minister's car door this morning, so very important job. Open the car door and say good morning, Prime Minister. There's no pressure at all, is there, Miss Jones?
Not at all.
See you later on, Miss Jones, have a good day.
I've actually never seen a real Prime Minister. I've only seen him on the TV, so this is quite good.
This is a particularly special moment for me because it is my first time as Prime Minister on board a Royal Navy ship. And it's a very proud one too, as I have the privilege of talking to you, our brave men and women, who put yourselves on the line to keep our people safe and protect Britain's interests around the world. So on behalf of everyone back in Britain, thank you. And let me be one of the first to wish you a peaceful Christmas and a very happy New Year. Thank you.
HMS Ocean! Ha! HMS Ocean! Turning right and forward!
I thought that was brilliant. Obviously, she's talking to two audiences. She's got the world media stood behind, but in front, she's got the ship's company of Ocean, and she spoke, I think, really well to them. So we're a cynical bunch sometimes, but everybody on board was super excited to see her today, so it's really nice. They'll all be talking about it later. Get a bite shot in the arm, halfway through deployment, get the Prime Minister wishing you a happy Christmas, and then in 3 hours and 5 minutes, we sail and crack on again.
There is one more important piece of business to attend to. Michael Golden has an appointment with the Beard Police.
How are we? I'm not too bad, thanks. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
So I just wanted to get my beard signed off.
OK, no problem. Obviously, I'm looking, make sure it's all level and attached to the side bend, and the moustache bit is attached to the beard. I'm happy with that because it's growing in nicely. So, yeah, I'm happy.
With that.
That'll be it. Obviously, if you want to shave it off again, you'll have to come and let me know, and then I'll give you this back, and then you'll have to grow in, if you want to grow a new one.
Sure.
Put another chit in. Thank you very much.
Perfect. Thank you, boss.
It's 80 days since the ship left Plymouth. Since then, the crew have coped with multiple engine problems, hosted diplomatic events, dropped 350 Marines into the desert, and pushed an air group through sea flying training.
Back home, what can you see when you look out, when you work it around those cities, buildings and that? Some trees, but can't get better than this. You can't.
The 120 new recruits and their shipmates are now ready to spend the next 3 months leading the task force and policing the Gulf.
But you see the confidence in the way that they walk and talk. My relief might be amongst this ship's company, and in a few years' time, the person who aspires to go and command the next fleet flagship might be here now. You know, I'm really proud of them, so, you know, job done so far.
Next Monday at 8, from dolls to computer parts, meet Britain's biggest hoarders and those who are trying to help them. Next tonight, bringing the groups together. How long before the first row? The Island with Bear Grylls continues.
Well done, mate.
Your family on a daily basis. It's that's normal, but it's the distractions like this that take your mind off it for a bit. And so it's good. It's passing the time away for the guys. So it's really a good thing for the boys, I think.
Away from the darts match, the Commodore and his staff are getting down to the day-to-day business of running the CTF 50 task force.
Okay. Thanks very much.
So, on open source, in Yemen...
One of their responsibilities is to coordinate anti-terrorist operations against ISIS and Al-Qaeda groups in the area. So there are daily security briefings.
...made by Saudi authorities. Michael H992, he's tweeted an image of the Salhan destroyer. This is a domestically built Iranian destroyer, sir, but it's more similar in size to an APB than destroyer.
Okay. Thanks, Matt. No questions.
As command ship of CTF 50, Ocean's flight deck has gotten busier. Today she'll welcome aboard an unusual American visitor. The Osprey is half plane, half helicopter, and can tilt its engines mid-air, transforming from one mode to the other in 12 seconds. It has the speed of an airplane, but the landing capability of a helicopter.
The
so it can carry troops, up to 24 people, over a great range, and at speed. So it gives us that versatility to get people ashore or whatever we need to do with it.
Only the American military operate the Osprey, so its arrival is greeted with genuine curiosity.
This is the first couple of days of CTF 50, so operating the Osprey with the Americans, it's a really good way to start. So, and it's enjoyable, it's something different.
Down in the galley, Marine technician Michael Hedgecock is in big trouble.
We were ashore one night, me and one of my really close friends, been drinking all day. It was the last stop before we were going home. Got into a bit of an argument. We may or may not have had a fight. And pretty much...
Start ahead, starboard engine.
A third of her sailors are at sea for the first time.
Got a postcard from my nan. See it every morning, it makes me happy.
And the old ship keeps throwing up problems.
Manual work, take out the strainers, clean them.
Now they're approaching the climax of their mission. Will the ship and her crew be up to scratch? Our cameras have been following Ocean to see what it takes to run a major warship. November the 6th, and HMS Ocean is 2,000 miles from home at the port of Duqm in Oman. Tomorrow she'll be heading for the Gulf and the most sensitive part of her mission. So the crew has got one last evening to relax. Below deck in the women's mess, 17-year-old apprentice engineer Kira Parry is providing the night's entertainment.
I had my rap night. So I performed live for the mess. That was good. That was awesome. I love my mess. It's awesome. Singing, dancing, rapping, just having a laugh with your mates. It's awesome. The best place of the ship.
Despite the high spirits, Ocean's crew has a testing time ahead. To get to the Gulf, Ocean has to navigate one of the most hostile stretches of water on Earth, a 20-mile wide choke point separating Iran and the Gulf states, the Strait of Hormuz. An encounter with the Iranian Navy is almost guaranteed. Ocean's operations officer, Adam Ridette, is in charge of intelligence.
What we've got here is video from the US warship that went through the Strait of Hormuz earlier in 2016. What she's videoing is four Iranian Republican Guards naval boats that come close, and this is something we fully expect to see because this is effectively Iran's backyard. So we've seen stories in the past about Iranian cruise missiles and swarms of small boats coming out to attack, but arguably not since the 70s has there ever been shots exchanged.
Act 1988, do you admit or deny the charge?
Admit, sir.
Do you or your AO on your behalf wish to make a plea in mitigation?
Yes, sir.
AO, please.
Sir, since the incident in question, Hedgecock has recognised that his actions were unacceptable and he had to identify his shortcomings and take actions to rectify them. Hedgecock has shown clear remorse for his actions and again wishes to apologise unreservedly to all parties concerned and to put the incident behind him.
Thank you, Chief. Well spoken. I do not believe that a custodial sentence is in the service interest, nor do I believe that stoppage of leave is appropriate. Therefore, having found the charge against you proved, I award you a fine of 14 days' pay, totalling £752.64, to be taken over two calendar months. I read through an inch thick of case notes. And the one question I have is, why didn't you walk away?
I thought he was going to
basically hit me first, and as he is a little bit stronger than me,
yeah.
I didn't want to lose face and I felt threatened. And I thought okay. That was my only way out, sir.
We are only violent towards the enemy, not each other. All right, so we are trained to be violent. It's what we do. But we're also trained when and where to use that violence. Far too many years ago, I stood exactly where you were. All right, so somebody gave me a chance on that day, and now I'm here as the commander of the fleet flagship. So I offer you the same chance today. Use it fully.
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes, sir.
Hey, yeah.
14 days pay.
Fine.
14 days pay. 750 quid. Very lucky.
In the grand scheme of things, that is the best case scenario. The best. I couldn't have asked for better. Really.
I'm happy.
Ocean is in port for a VIP visit.
The Prime Minister will be coming on board the vehicle ramp, up the vehicle deck, on the aft lift and onto the flight deck, so we'll make sure that area is nice and clean.
Prime Minister Theresa May is in Bahrain for a post-Brexit trip to drum up trade. But it's also an opportunity for her to come aboard and celebrate the ship taking command of CTF 50. She will give a speech, meet the crew, and thank them for their efforts.
Attention.
Before she arrives, Captain Pedra and Commodore Burns brief the troops to make sure.
Two navies just having a look at each other in the same stretch of water.
Now Ocean can focus on the next stage of her mission, to command CTF 50, the American-led naval task force in the Gulf. Stoker Michael Hedgecock is the fifth generation of his family to serve in the Royal Navy. But even born sailors like Michael can have an off day on a long voyage.
Some days when you've had a really bad day, and you just want a bit of fatherly advice, just to say, listen, Dad, X, Y, and Z's happened. I just need someone to chat to, or can we just go for a pint and just chill? Sometimes you just need your mum and your dad just to say everything's going to be all right.
Homesickness is the enemy of good morale. Luckily, there is an antidote. The post.
Where's Tom APG? Oh, over there.
Over there.
And then that pile.
Ships get deliveries either at sea or when they arrive in port. Today, there are 66 sacks worth of parcels and letters. Some sections of the crew account for more of it than others.
Girls' mess always does really well. There's always tons.
Why do you think that is?
Because we're just loved. We're just loved more than everybody else.
Apprentice stoker Kate Benson has got two sacks full of love for her mess.
Today.
I've got some salmon, some mug shots, and chocolate biscuits. They're my favourite. I got a little parcel the other day and there was just a little note in there, just makes it a bit better to receive.
Yeah, even like a card, I think
it's
like good, isn't it?
Yeah. Got a postcard from my nan. Love it. See it every morning, it makes me happy.
The mail makes everyone's day.
Right, so I'm going to open some mail.
Even the captain, see. Who has a bundle of parcels from his parents.
In fact, yeah, it's a book on history. Max Hastings, Battle for Japan, which is a subject I'm pretty interested in. I suspect another book. Yeah, Turning the Tide, Battle of Coral Sea, an absolute essential read. Yep, lots of books.
To wind down.
We'll debrief shortly.
It was at green weather. Confirm you have no idea.
After 6 hours, Ocean clears the strait.
Well, I think we've seen a pretty standard pattern of Iranian activity, albeit to have had interactions with some 18 Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps Navy vessels is quite a high number, it's probably fair to say, but equally it's a while since they've seen a Royal Navy aircraft carrier operating in this area, so they've evidently rolled out the red carpet for us today to welcome us into the Gulf.
The crew has remained calm under pressure and avoided any incident.
You know, I'm really proud of them because it's too easy to just remember your Hollywood movies and go all medieval every time you see the enemy. But for here, it takes real intelligence and restraint to recognise the situation for what it was, which is two navies just having a look at each other in the same stretch of water.
Now Ocean can focus on the next stage of her mission, to command CTF 50, the American-led naval task force in the Gulf. Stoker Michael Hedgecock is the fifth generation of his family to serve in the Royal Navy. But even born sailors like Michael can have an off day on a long voyage.
Some days when you've had a really bad day, you just want a bit of fatherly advice. Just to say, listen, Dad, X, Y, and Z's happened. I just need someone to chat to, or can we just go for a pint and just chill? And sometimes you just need your mum and your dad just to say everything's going to be all right.
Homesickness is the enemy of good morale. Luckily, there is an antidote. The post.
Where's Tommy PG?
Oh, over there.
Over there.
And then that pile.
Ships get deliveries either at sea or when they arrive in port. Today, there are 66 sacks worth of parcels and letters. Some sections of the crew account for more of it than others.
Girls' mess always does really well. There's always tons.
Why do you think that is?
Because we're just loved. We're just loved more than everybody else.
Apprentice stoker Kate Benson has got two sacks full of love for her mess.
This is the eighth package I've had today.
To the north in the shape of ISIS and to the south in the form of Al-Qaeda. We know those organisations are developing waterborne threats and we have to be ready to deal with those.
Start ahead, starboard engine.
Ocean is now on course for a rendezvous with the aircraft carrier USS Eisenhower. This nuclear-powered aircraft carrier is three times the size of Ocean and has a crew of 5,000. In 2 weeks' time, the British warship will replace her at the head of the task force. New recruits to the Royal Navy have centuries of tradition and regulation to navigate. Today, new recruit Michael Golden is about to encounter one of their more bizarre rules.
Yeah, not bad. I want to grow a beard, if that's okay.
So I need you to familiarise yourselves with the policy of BR3.
If you want a beard in the Navy, you need the right paperwork.
So, in order to be able to grow a beard, you have to fill out a beard chip, which in effect is a request to cease shaving from a certain date. So what happens then is I'll fill out the form. Having done so, I'll then get that signed by my divisional officer and the Master at Arms. And then in a couple of weeks, she'll take a look, see if it actually is respectable. And if she thinks it is, happy days. If she doesn't, then you have to shave it off, start again.
The master at arms is Shelley Hyatt.
What I'm looking for is that it's coming through evenly. There's not gaps everywhere and spaces, or it's the correct length and it's not, it's longer than just a bit of fluff on their chin, basically, and it looks neat and tidy.
On the flight deck, there are more pressing concerns. Captain Pedra and Commodore Burns are preparing to be flown by helicopter to the USS Eisenhower. There, an American admiral will formally hand command of his task force to Commodore Burns and Ocean.
Roger, it's in November. Thank you. We are minutes away from taking over as the flagship of Commander Task Force 50, so Maritime Coalition Strike Ops in the Gulf. So the Commodore's over there at the moment taking over that duty. And we are just positioning ourselves for a little steam past with USS Eisenhower, who is...
The British Commodore has a meeting on the American destroyer, USS Hopper. It's a lively commute. Hopper is one of two American destroyers in the task force. Both carry Tomahawk cruise missiles. These are capable of striking ISIS and Al-Qaeda targets in Iraq. Ocean also has an appointment to keep. She is due to carry out one of her more challenging operations.
Approach, Roger. Take quarters. Port 15, altering 315.
The ship is meeting a floating filling station for ARAS, which stands for Replenishment at Sea. She is topping up her tanks with 400 tons of diesel and a further 200 tons of aviation fuel. It takes 57 gallons to move Ocean 1 nautical mile. The ship uses 7 gallons to travel her own length. That's 667 feet.
Oh, we're getting closer.
For once, Kira is above deck.
Yeah. Thank
you. She's on comms duty, which means she's a key link between the engine room and the pumping operation.
I love the RAS. I think they're awesome. They can get a bit boring, actually, but afterwards you just buzz in. Especially, like, being on the comms, you just feel like you're so important.
In principle, it's just like filling up at a petrol station. In practice, it's a bit more tricky.
As the ships push through the water, they create a pressure wave at the bow, so they push water away from themselves, and that can push, you know, push the ships apart. Luckily, they do that at the back as well, so the front and the back are pushing out, but in the middle, between the two ships, it's actually trying to suck you together. So it balances nicely. But if you get it wrong, and sort of get too far ahead or too far back, then it sort of sucks you together, and that can go a bit disastrously wrong.
Sorry? Starboard 20, altering 325. Starboard 20. Very good. Very good.
Almost exactly 50 metres apart, steaming along at 10 knots, 21,000 tonnes on this side, 16,000 tonnes on the other side. Living the dream.
Once they are close enough, they get a line over.
Turn the back for life, boys.
Oh, they've got this like attachment for the SA-80. And they fire it over and it's got like catch on something over there.
Right for ready.
It's like how you send stuff over. Fire away.
No matter what rank you are, there's only one way to board a warship at sea.
Project A, can we make one final peel off the FDX pipe, please?
British Commodore Andrew Burns will arrive through the maritime equivalent of the tradesman's entrance, known on ship as the pilot's hatch. A Commodore is responsible for a squadron of ships and is one rank below a rear admiral, which means he gets his own flag raised when aboard.
This is my 8th deployment to the Middle East and the Gulf region, so it's pretty familiar territory to me, and it's a difficult part of the world to operate in. It's particularly challenging right now because there is instability all the way around the Gulf region and terrorist organisations operating to the north in the shape of ISIS and to the south in the form of Al-Qaeda. We know those organisations are developing waterborne threats and we have to be ready to deal with those.
Start ahead, starboard engine.
Ocean is now on course for a rendezvous with the aircraft carrier USS Eisenhower. This nuclear-powered aircraft carrier is 3 times the size of Ocean and has a crew of 5,000. In 2 weeks' time, the British warship will replace her at the head of the task force. New recruits to the Royal Navy have centuries of tradition and regulation to navigate. Today, new recruit Michael Golden is about to encounter one of their more bizarre rules.
I want to grow a beard, if that's okay.
So I need you to familiarise yourselves with the policy in BR3.
If you want a beard in the Navy, you need the right paperwork.
So in order to be able to grow a beard, you have to fill out a beard chip, which in effect is a request to cease shaving from a certain date. So what happens then is I'll fill out the form. Having done so, I'll then get that signed by my divisional officer and the Master at Arms. And then in a couple of weeks, she'll take a look, see if it actually is respectable. And if she thinks it is, happy days. If she doesn't, then you have to shave it off, start again.
In a pre-health and safety era, ship-to-ship transfer was even used to move people.
When I was 18, I transferred between a couple of frigates, and I think they found out it was my birthday, so they stopped me halfway across and bounced me in and out of the water, singing happy birthday, and I thought it was the best day of my life. So 30 years ago, that was it was a good day, but Christ alive, we do that today. Can't think about it.
It will take over 4 hours to pump the fuel aboard. The cost of filling up today? £200,000.
ETME Hedgecock.
Sir!
Today, Michael Hedgecock will stand trial for assaulting a shipmate.
Off cap. Stand at ease.
Hedgecock is facing the real possibility that he has messed up the only career he has ever wanted.
Paul Hedgecock, you are charged as follows: committing a criminal conduct offence contrary to Section 42 of the Armed Forces Act 2006, namely battery, to Section 39 of the Criminal Justice Act 1988. Do you admit or deny the charge?
Admit, sir.
Do you or your AO on your behalf wish to make a plea in mitigation?
Yes, sir.
AO, please.
Sir. Since the incident in question, Hedgecock has recognised that his actions were unacceptable and he had to identify his shortcomings and take actions to rectify them. Hedgecock has shown clear remorse for his actions and again wishes to apologise unreservedly to all parties concerned and to put the incident behind him.
Thank you, Chief. Well spoken. I do not believe that a custodial sentence is in the service interest, nor do I believe that stoppage of leave is appropriate. Therefore, having found the charge against you proved, I award you a fine of 14 days' pay, totalling £752.64, to be taken over 2 calendar months.
Sir.
I read through an inch thick of case notes. And the one question I have is, why didn't you walk away?
I thought he was going to basically hit me first, and as he is a little bit stronger than me,
yep.
I didn't want to lose face and I felt threatened. And I thought that was my only way out, sir.
We are only violent towards the enemy, not each other. Right, so we are trained to be violent. It's what we do. But we are also trained when and where to use that violence. Far too many years ago, I stood exactly where you were. Right, so somebody gave me a chance on that day, and now I'm here as the commander of the fleet flagship. So I offer you the same chance today.
use it fully.
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes, sir.
Hey, yeah.
14 days pay.
Pip and her crew be up to scratch. Our cameras have been following Ocean to see what it takes to run a major warship. Early evening, November the 6th, and HMS Ocean is 2,000 miles from home at the port of Duqm in Oman. Tomorrow she'll be heading for the Gulf and the most sensitive part of her mission. So the crew has got one last evening to relax. Below deck in the women's mess, 17-year-old apprentice engineer Kira Parry is providing the night's entertainment.
I had my rap night. So I performed live for the mess. That was good. That was awesome. I love my mess. It's awesome. Singing, dancing, rapping, just having a laugh with your mates. It's awesome. The best place of the ship.
Despite the high spirits, Ocean's crew has a testing time ahead. To get to the Gulf, Ocean has to navigate one of the most hostile stretches of water on Earth, a 20-mile wide choke point separating Iran and the Gulf states, the Strait of Hormuz. An encounter with the Iranian Navy is almost guaranteed. Ocean's operations officer, Adam Ridette, is in charge of intelligence.
What we've got here is video from the US warship that went through the Strait of Hormuz earlier in 2016. What she's videoing is four Iranian Republican Guards naval boats that come close, and this is something we fully expect to see because this is effectively Iran's backyard. So we've seen stories in the past about Iranian cruise missiles and swarms of small boats coming out to attack, but arguably not since the 70s has there ever been shots exchanged. So if something does happen, it will be a miscalculation, a mistake. We don't want to escalate that, and frankly, nor do the Iranians.
It's 6 a.m. and Ocean through the maritime equivalent of the tradesman's entrance, known on ship as the pilot's hatch. A Commodore is responsible for a squadron of ships and is one rank below a rear admiral, which means he gets his own flag raised when aboard.
This is my 8th deployment to the Middle East and the Gulf region, so it's pretty familiar territory to me, and it's a difficult part of the world to operate in. It's particularly challenging right now because there is instability all the way around the Gulf region and terrorist organizations operating to the north in the shape of ISIS and to the south in the form of Al-Qaeda. We know those organizations are developing waterborne threats, and we have to be ready to deal with those.
Start ahead, starboard engine.
Ocean is now on course for a rendezvous with the aircraft carrier USS Eisenhower. This nuclear-powered aircraft carrier is three times the size of Ocean and has a crew of 5,000. In 2 weeks' time, the British warship will replace her at the head of the task force. New recruits to the Royal Navy have centuries of tradition and regulation to navigate. Today, new recruit Michael Golden is about to encounter one of their more bizarre rules.
Yeah, not bad. I want to grow a beard, if that's okay.
So I need you to familiarise yourselves with the policy in BR3.
If you want a beard in the Navy, you need the right paperwork.
So in order to be able to grow a beard, you have to fill out a beard chip, which in effect is a request to cease shaving from a certain date. So what happens then is I'll fill out the form. Having done so, I'll then get that signed by my divisional officer and the Master at Arms. And then in a couple of weeks, she'll take a look, see if it actually is respectable. And if she thinks it is, happy days. If she doesn't, then you have to shave it off, start again.
The Master at Arms is Shelley Hyatt.
What I'm looking for is that it's coming through evenly. There's not gaps everywhere and spaces, or it's the correct length and it's not, it's longer than just